Today we will learn about anatomy of the genital tract. Uterus and the vagina are wonderful organs in our body. In that, in every cycle, the uterus prepares itself to receive the conceptus, and if not conceived, it sheds its endothelial lining every month and again prepares for the nest. During pregnancy, it expands to such an extent, even to accommodate 3, 4, even 7 or 8 fetuses. And the cervix is tightly closed to keep the conceptus inside. And at the time of labor, it begins to contract, which is opposite to its physiological function during pregnancy. At the same time, the cervix, till keeping it tightly closed, relaxes, again a physiologically opposite function. And after delivery, in the puerperium, or the organ returns to its normal state. There is no such organ in our body having such a physiological and diametrically opposite function. So this physiological function and the pathology of this organ can be fully understood only if you are thorough with the anatomy of the genital organs. Now, the era is of technology. We use various imaging techniques like ultrasound, CT, MRI, etc. And to understand the findings of this imaging techniques, we should know the relationship and the genital organ to the surrounding structures and the anatomy well. Then only we can interpret the findings and any pathology. Again, during surgery, the duty pathology, the anatomy may be distorted. So only unless you don't know the anatomy, normal anatomy, you may likely to injure the surrounding organs like ureter, bladder, rectum, etc. Also, a knowledge of anatomy will help you in complete resection of the pathology or tumor when there is a cancer of the genital organ. And also, the knowledge of the lymphatic drainage is also essential in doing a radical surgery. Female genital organs can be divided into external genitalia, which consists of the vulva, and the internal genitalia, consisting of vagina, uterus, and adnexe. The vulva, which includes the whole external genitalia, extends anteriorly from the mons veneris to the perineum posteriorly. On the lateral side, it is bounded by the labia majora on both sides. The parts of the vulva are mons pubis or mons veneris, labia majora, labia minora, the vestibule, and the contents are clitoris, vestibular glands, Bartholin glands, and the skin glands. Labia majora, which forms the lateral boundary of the external genitalia, are fold of skin which encloses fat. It extends from the mons veneris anteriorly to the skin over the perineum posteriorly. Mons veneris is nothing but a pad of fat overlying the symphysis pubis. And the mons, the lateral part of labia, are hairy, whereas inner side is soft and hairless. The fullness of the labia majora are mainly due to the amount of fat which contains within it. And the amount of fat all depends on the hormones. In reproductive age group, it is well developed and it often covers the cleft between the labia majora and is not visible, the vaginal orifice is not visible in the reproductive age group in the normal position. Whereas in menopausal women and premenarchal girls, this pad of fat is not so prominent. Hence, the cleft between them will be visible in the anatomical position. Scrotum is the masculine counterpart of labia majora. Labia minora are thick folds of skin lying medial to the labia majora on either side. It lacks any fat or hair. It encircles the urethra anteriorly and the vaginal orifice posteriorly. And the two labia minora fuse posteriorly to form the posterior portion. And anteriorly, it divides into two, and meeting with the counterpart of its opposite side, above and below the clitoris, forming the prepuce and frenulum of the clitoris. Vestibule is the triangular area bounded anteriorly by the clitoris, posteriorly by the posterior foreshoe, and on the sides by the labia minora. It encircles the urethral orifice anteriorly and the vaginal orifice posteriorly. Paraurethral glands or skin glands opens in and around the urethra. Bartholin's gland duct opens on the posterior part of the vestibule just outside the hymen. Hymen is a thin membrane which partially covers the vagina in the virgin. During coitus, it gets lacerated, especially on the posterior part, sometimes causing brisk hemorrhage. Childbirth causes multiple laceration of the hymen, often reducing it to small remnants around the vaginal orifice, called as carangulae myrtiformis. This has medico-legal importance. The area between the posterior margin of the hymen and the posterior commissure is called posterior portia, is called fossa navicularis. Clitoris is a small cylindrical organ about 1.5 cm in length and 0.5 cm in diameter, situated at the anterior part of the vestibule. It has a glands, a body, and a two crura, which lies underneath the ischiocavernous muscle. It is an erectile tissue, very much vascular and sensitive, and is analogous to the penis in the male. Vestibular glands are two erectile tissue lying beneath the mucosa of the vestibule surrounding the vaginal orifice. It lies anterior to the Bartholin's glands and are analogous to the single gland of penis and corpus spongiosum in the male. Vestibular glands lie anterior to the Bartholin's gland and underneath the bulbo cavernous muscle surrounding the vagina. Both clitoris and vestibular glands are erectile tissue and plays a part in the female orgasm. They are highly vascular and sensitive, and during childbirth may get lacerated, causing brisk hemorrhage. Hyperandrogenism may cause hypertrophy of the clitoris, causing clitoromegaly. Bartholin glands are almond-shaped glands located on the posterolateral aspect of the vaginal orifice. It lies deep to the bulbocavernous muscle and is ducted open into the vaginal orifice outside the hymen at the junction of the upper two-thirds and lower one-third. Histologically, it is a compound racemose gland and its secretions lubricate the vagina during sexual intercourse. It corresponds to the bulbourethral glands in the male. In the physiological state, the glands are not visible or palpable, but when it gets inflamed, often due to infection, especially gonococcal infection, and the inflamed duct opening can be seen at the vaginal orifice. When the ducts are getting blocked due to any reason, if the secretions get pending and you get a Bartholin cyst, it can also develop a carcinoma. Vulval skin is exactly similar to the skin covering the other parts of the body. It contains sweat and sebaceous glands. It also contains some specialized type of sweat glands called apocrine gland, which gives the characteristic aroma of the genital area. Rarely, a tumor of the apocrine glands can develop what we call as the hidradenoma. All types of skin lesions can occur on the vulva, including malignancy. The subcutaneous tissues of the vulva is in communication with the subcutaneous tissue of the lower abdomen. Hence, any infection or inflammation on either side can extend or involve the both area. But the subcutaneous fascia is fusing with along the pubic, ischiopubic rami and along the inguinal ligament. Hence, any infection or inflammation is limited involving the medial side of the thigh. The blood supply to the vulva are mainly through branches of the internal pudendal and femoral artery. The branches of the internal pudendal artery are labial artery, transverse perineal artery, superficial and deep artery of the clitoris, and artery of the vestibular bulb. Femoral artery, through its superficial and deep pudendal artery, supplies the vulva. The veins form plexus and drain into internal pudendal vein or to the vesical and vaginal venous plexus. It can also drain into the long saphenous vein. Due to its rich vascularity, it is predisposed to varicosities during pregnancy and liable to develop hematoma either due to childbirth or due to trauma. The mons veneris and upper part of the labia majora are getting innervated from the L1 and L2 lumbar nerve roots through the ilioinguinal nerve and the genital branch of genitofemoral. The posterior and lateral parts of the vulva are innervated from the sacral 2-3-4 nerve roots through the pudendal branches of the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh and the labial and perineal branches of the pudendal nerve. The external genitalia conveniently includes the perineum also. The anatomical perineum is a diamond-shaped area with extending from the under surface of the pelvic diaphragm superiorly to the skin below, which in between the buttocks and the thigh. The boundaries of the perineum are anteriorly the pubic bone, the sides, ischiopubic rami, ischial tuberosity, and posteriorly the coccyx, and on the sides the sacrotuberous ligament. It is having a diamond or rhombus shape, or it can be considered as two triangles placed at different planes but with a common base at a line joining the two ischial tuberosity. The anterior triangle is called urogenital triangle. The posterior is called anal triangle. Only the urogenital triangle has obstetrical importance. The anterior triangle of perineum is otherwise called as a urogenital triangle. Its boundaries are anteriorly the subpubic angle, laterally ischiopubic rami, ischial tuberosity, and posteriorly the subosteal transverse perineum muscle. The vulva and its contents overlie the urogenital triangle, and it is pierced by the terminal part of urethra and vagina. It contains the superficial and the perineal pouches. The superficial perineal pouch contains the superficial transverse perineal muscle, bulbo cavernous muscle which overlies the vestibular valves, and the ischio cavernous muscle which overlies the crura of the clitoris. The deep perineal pouch contains the inferior and superior fascia of the urogenital diaphragm and the deep transverse perineal muscle and the sphincter urethra between the two layers. Both pouches contains blood vessels and nerves and lymphatics. The urogenital triangle is often traumatized during childbirth and hence have obstetric importance. The posterior triangle, otherwise called the anal triangle, its boundaries are anteriorly the superficial transverse perineal muscle, posteriorly the coccyx, and on the sides have the sacrotuberous ligament. The contents are terminal part of the anal canal, external anal sphincter, the anococcygeal body, and on the sides ischiorectal fossa. It contains blood vessels, nerves, and lymphatic. Even though of least obstetric importance, since it shares the base with the base of the urogenital triangle, the trauma to the urogenital triangle during childbirth may sometimes involve the anal sphincter and the anal canal. The obstetrical perineum is different from anatomical perineum. It is otherwise called perineal body or central point of perineum. It is a pyramidal shaped tissue with the apex pointing upwards and in continuous with the rectovaginal septum. And the lower part is the skin between the posterior vaginal wall and the anterior wall of the anal canal. It is the meeting point of different layers. Starting from above is the pelvic diaphragm, perineal muscles and fascia in between the vagina and anal canal. The layers of the perineal body are from below upwards, skin, subdural tissue which is two layers of fascia, then the superficial perineal muscles, namely the bulbo cavernous and the superficial deep transverse perineum. The ischio cavernous muscle doesn't come in the obstetric perineum because it lies too laterally. Above the superficial perineal muscles lies the urogenital diaphragm, which is inferior and superior fascia and its contents. The inferior fascia is otherwise called perineal membrane. The contents of the urogenital diaphragm are deep transverse perineal muscle and sphincter urethra. Above the urogenital diaphragm, we have the pubococcygeus part of the levator and a muscle. The importance of obstetrical perineum is it is often get traumatized during childbirth, and to avoid a trauma to the or lacerated perineum, we often do a deliberate incision on the perineum during the childbirth, what we call as the episiotomy, which is the most common surgery done in obstetrics. Vagina is the lower part of the internal genitalia. It is a fibromuscular membranous sheath connecting the uterus to the exterior at the vulva. It functions as an excretory channel for the uterine secretions and menstrual blood. It is the organ of copulation and function as the birth canal. It has immense capacity to dilate as evidenced during childbirth. Coming to the anatomy, in anatomical position, the direction of the vagina is backward and upwards, which is upper one third lying horizontally above the pelvic diaphragm. The longitudinal axis of the vagina is parallel to the inlet of the pelvis. The uterus lies at right angles to the vagina in its upper part, and the cervix pierces the anterior vaginal wall, forming a shallow anterior fornix, a deep posterior fornix, and two lateral fornices. The vagina has an anterior wall, posterior wall, and two lateral walls. And in physiological state, the anterior and posterior vaginal walls are in approximation, giving in the cross section an H shape. The vagina is narrowest at the introitus and widest at the apex. Histologically, vagina has four layers: the inner mucosa, behind it is a submucosa which contains areolar tissue and is very much vascular. Outer to the submucosa is the muscular layer, which contains two layers of muscle, inner circular and outer longitudinal, and the outer layer is the fibrous cord found by the pelvic fascia. The vaginal mucosa is stratified squamous epithelium. It is just like skin, devoid of any glands. It has the multi-layered. Superficial layer consists of cornified cells, It is multi-layered. Below it is the intermediate cell or the parabasal cell layer, and innermost is the, or outer to it is the basal cell. The thickness of the epithelium depends on the hormonal status. It is multi-layered, especially the superficial epithelium is multi-layered in a reproductive age group due to the influence of estrogen, whereas it will become thin and the basal and parabasal cells predominate in the basal and parabasal cell predominate in the menopausal years and in the premenarchal years. The vaginal epithelium is rich in glycogen under the influence of estrogen, and this glycogen is converted to lactic acid by dodrogen bacilli present in the vagina and resulting acidic pH of the vagina. Usually the pH of the vagina varies from 4 to 5.5, and the usual pH, normal pH, is about around 4.5. Vaginal secretions are mainly transudate, and it also contributed by secretions from the uterine glands and the cervical glands, plus at the time of sexual excitement or during the coitus, contributed by the Bartholin's gland. Coming to the relationship of the vagina, the anterior vaginal wall is related to the bladder in its upper two-thirds and lower one-third to the urethra. Posteriorly, upper one-third of the vagina is related to the Boucher Douglas, middle one-third to the rectum, and lower one-third of the posterior vaginal wall is related to the perineum. On the sides, on the upper part, you have the lateral fornis, where it is related to the uterine vessels and the ureter, which lies nearly 2 cm from the lateral fornis. In the middle part, you have the muscles, levator ani, pubococcygeus part of the levator ani muscle, fusing with the lateral wall of the vagina. And below, the lower part of the vagina, we have the bulbocavernous muscle, the vestibular bulbs, and Bartholin glands related to the lateral part of the vagina. The vagina is supported at its apex by the triradiate ligament, which fixes it to the sacrum posteriorly, to the lateral pelvic wall, and to the pubis anteriorly. Laterally, the vagina is supported or attached anteriorly to the arcus tendineus fasciae pelvis and posteriorly to the arcus tendineus fasciae rectalis. And lower part of the vagina is supported by the perineal muscles. Vagina is supplied by the vaginal artery, which is a branch of uterine artery. Occasionally, it may arise directly from the internal iliac artery. There is also contribution from the cervical vaginal branch of uterine artery, middle rectal and internal pudendal arteries. The vaginal artery descends downwards along the lateral wall of the vagina, and while descending, it gives multiple transverse branches to the anterior and posterior surface of the vagina. These transverse branches anastomose with the branches of its counterpart on the other side and form two azygos arteries, which run downwards in the anterior and posterior wall of the vagina. Vein follow the course of the arteries and drain into internal iliac and internal pudendal. Nerve supply to the vagina are mainly sympathetic and parasympathetic. Only the lower part of the vagina receives somatic supply through the pudendal nerve and is sensitive to touch and pain. Uterus is a piriform shaped muscular hollow organ interposed between the bladder anteriorly and rectum posteriorly. In the normal position, the uterus is antiverted and antiflushed about 90% of the cases, whereas 10% of the women may have a retroverted and retroflushed uterus. Version means the direction of the cervical canal with respect to the longitudinal axis of the vagina, whereas flexion means the relationship between the longitudinal axis of the cervical canal to the longitudinal axis of the body of the uterus. In an antiverted uterus, the cervical canal is directed downward and backward, and in antiflexed uterus, the body of the uterus lies anterior to the longitudinal axis of the cervical canal. And antiverted uterus usually is antiflexed also. And in physiologically, 90% of the woman may have an antiverted and antiflexed uterus. When the cervical canal is directed downward and forward, and the body of the uterus lies posterior to the axis of the cervical canal, we say it is a retroverted and retroflexed uterus. 10% of the woman may have a retroverted and retroflexed uterus, which is physiological. But retroverted and retroflexed uterus may be pathological also, in which case it may be bound down to the Poucher Douglas with adhesion due to pathology. Whereas a physiologically retroverted uterus will be mobile. The size of the uterus is roughly about 8 cm in length, 5 cm in width, and 1.5 cm in thickness. It has a fundus, body, and a cervix. Fundus is the area above the insertion of the fallopian tube, and the junction between the fundus and body where the appendages like the fallopian tube, round ligament, and the ovarian ligaments are attached is called the cornua of the uterus. From the cornua up to the isthmus is the body of the uterus, and the body communicates with the cervix, the isthmus. Isthmus is the area between the histological internal loss and the anatomical internal loss. The uterine cavity is an inverted triangular with three openings. At the base, we have the medial openings of the fallopian tube, and at the apex of the triangle is the internal loss, which opens into the cervical canal. The attachments of the uterus are mainly on the lateral side, while the anterior and posterior surface of the uterus are relatively free. Coming to the lateral attachment, starting from the above downwards, the coronal attachments are the fallopian tube, ovarian ligament, and the round ligament. The fallopian tube is in the middle, and the round ligament is attached anteromedial to the fallopian tube. and it goes in the anterior leaf of the broad ligament, anterolaterally to the internal inguinal ring, and through it passes to the labia majora, where it gets inserted. Posterior, inferior to the fallopian tube, is the ovarian ligament, which is attached to the uterine ball of the ovary. Below the coronal attachment is the broad ligament, which is nothing but two folds of peritoneum. This is formed by the convergence of the parietal peritoneum, which covers the anterior and posterior abdominal wall, and it converges on to the lateral side of the uterus, forming the broad ligament. It is rectangular in shape. Upper border is free and engulfed is medial 3/4, the fallopian tube. The lower border is again covers the parametrium and is reflected onto the anterior and posterior wall of the abdomen respectively. The medial border of the broad ligament is attached to the lateral border of the body of the uterus from the internal lobes up to the corona. And the lateral, and it contains the ascending part of the uterine vessels. The lateral border of the broad ligament is attached to the lateral pelvic wall. The broad ligament contains blood vessels and lymphatics. Below the broad ligament, we have the triradiate ligament, which is the condensation of the pelvic cellular tissue. It is attached to the supravaginal part of the cervix and the upper part of the vagina. It has three ramifications. The posterolateral part goes to the sacrum to get attached to the sacrum and is known as a uterosacral ligament. This pulls the cervix posteriorly, causing antiflexion. One part goes to the lateral pelvic wall, and this part of the triradiate ligament is called Mackenroth's ligament or the cardinal ligament or the transverse cervical ligament. And the anterior part goes under the bladder to the pubic bone, forming the pubovesicocervical ligament. Below the parametrium or the triradiate ligament, we have the vagina attached to the cervix, the middle of the cervix, all around, dividing the cervix into a supravaginal portion and the portio vaginalis. Coming to the anterior and posterior attachments of the uterus. The anterior parietal peritoneum, after covering the anterior abdominal wall, is reflected onto the fundus of the bladder, and from there it is reflected onto the uterus at the level of the internal lobes, forming the uterovesical fold of peritoneum, commonly called the UV fold of peritoneum. And the peritoneum is covering the body and fundus of the uterus, where it is firmly attached to the uterus, forming the perimetrium or serosa of the uterus, and covers the fundus and the entire uterus, posteriorly the cervix and the upper part of the vagina, and is reflected onto the rectum at the junction of the upper and middle two-thirds, forming the rectovaginal pouch, or commonly called the pouch of Douglas. The UV fold of peritoneum can be easily identified during surgery by its loose attachment and can be easily picked up, whereas the rest of the peritoneum over the uterus is firmly adherent. And the UV folder peritoneum is an important surgical landmark, which is at the level of the internal loss. And the internal loss is where the uterine artery abandons its horizontal course and assumes a vertical course on the side of the uterus. And while it ascends, it crosses the ureter about 1.5 to 2 cm lateral to the internal loss. And remember, anteriorly, the cervix is not covered by the peritoneum, and the cervix and upper part of the vagina is relation to the bladder. So any growth on the cervix can be easily spread to the bladder, whereas on the posterior part, the pouch of Douglas separates the rectum from the cervix and the upper part of the vagina and relatively gives some protection to the tumor spread. And spread to the rectum is relatively late compared to the spread to bladder. Coming to the histology of the uterus. Uterus has three layers: the inner endometrium, middle myometrium, and the outer perimetrium or serosa. The inner endometrium is lined by a single layer of columnar cells and is responsive to hormones, and its character and thickness varies with the phase of the ovarian cycle. Myometrium has three layers: the inner circular, the intermediate layer which consists is thicker and consists of interdigitating muscle fibers arranged in obliquely and has important in attaining hemostasis. And the outer muscular layer is a longitudinal layer. And outside the muscle layer, we have the perimetrium, which is formed by the peritoneal covering of the uterus. The cervix is mainly made of fibrous tissue and small amount of muscle fibers. The lining linings of the cervical canal is ciliated columnar epithelium, and the ectocervix is covered by the stratified squamous epithelium. The meeting point of the squamous epithelium, which covers the ectocervix, and the columnar epithelium, which covers the cervical canal, is called squamocolumnar junction. And this squamocolumnar junction is not stationary. At birth, it may be lying outside the cervical canal on the ectocervix. As the age advances, this area, squamous epithelium, the columnar epithelium, is replaced by the metaplastic squamous epithelium, and the squamocolumnar junction moves inwards, and at menopause it may be even inside the cervical canal. So the area between the original squamocolumnar junction and the new squamocolumnar junction is called the transformation zone, and this is very important area of the cervix where it is the most common site for dysplasia and malignancy. Uterus is supplied by the uterine artery running on the lateral border of the uterus on either side. And the uterine artery ends by dividing into three branches, one running to the fundus, other to the round ligament, and the another branch going supplying the fallopian tube, where it anastomoses the branches of the aorian artery in the mesosalpinx. With the uterine artery, when it ascends along the sides of the uterus, gives anterior and posterior branches, which runs transversely on the surface of the uterus, and this branch is called arcade artery. And from the arcade artery, there are perpendicular branches which pierces the myometrium, called the radial artery. And the radial artery ends by dividing into two end arteries, one running parallel to the endometrium, called supplying the basal endometrium, is called basal artery, and the other is supplying the superficial endometrium, running perpendicular to the endometrium, is called superficial spiral artery. The veins drain through the uterine vein to the internal iliac vein on either side. Nerve supply to the uterus is mainly sympathetic and parasympathetic. Sympathetic, the motor fibers come through the T5 and T6 nerve roots, and the sensory through the T10 and L1 up to T10, T11, 12 and L1 nerve roots. Parasympathetic enters the uterus through the sacral nerve roots 2, 3 and 4 and form the pelvic nerves, and it ends in the ganglia of Frankenhuser on either side of the cervix. The proportion of the cervix and the body of the uterus changes with the age. In an infant, it may be the cervix may be larger compared to the body, and the proportion is of the cervix to the body is 2:1. In the reproductive age, there is preferential enlargement of the body and fundus of the uterus, resulting the changing the proportion to a cervix to the body as 1:2 or 1:3. During the after menopause, there is atrophy of the uterus and more to the posterior vaginalis of the cervix, which are precious with the vault of the vagina. Fallopian tubes are paired fimbriated structures situated about 10 cm long and situated on the upper free border of the fallopian of the rod ligament, in the medial three occupying the medial 3/4 of the of its free border. It's about 10 cm long and has 5 parts. From medial to lateral is the interstitial, isthmial, ambulary, infundibulum and the fimbria. The interstitial part is about 1.25 cm long and 1 mm in width. Is situated within the myometrium. It medially it opens at the cornua through the ostia, and the lateral end is continuous with the isthmial part of the tube. The isthmial part is about 2.5 cm long and 2 mm wide and often used as a site for sterilization. This is in continuity with the ambula, which is the widest part of the tube, about 5 cm long and 6 cm wide, where is the area for fertilization. Ambula is continued as infundibulum, which is around about 1.25 cm long and surrounded by the and opens into the abdominal cavity through the abdominal ostia. The abdominal ostia surrounded by fimbriae, and one of the fimbriae is long and is called ovarian fimbriae, which is attached to the outer pole of the ovary. Histologically, the tube has three layers. The inner lining is covered by the partially ciliated columnar epithelium arranged in longitudinal folds. Outer to it is the muscular layer and the serosa covering the muscular layer. Blood supply to the fallopian tube are both ovarian and uterine artery branches, which anastomoses in the mesosyphenes. The veins drain into the pampiniform plexus and into the ovarian vein. Coming to the function of the tube, it is the site for transport of the gametes. It's a meeting point of the gametes. Also, it transports the fertilized ovum into the uterine cavity and nourishes the ovum while it is getting transported to the uterine cavity. It is also the common site for ectopic. For sterilization, we usually use the isthmial portion of the tube, and inflammation and formation or adhesion often resulting blockage of the tube and may result in infertility. 30-40% of infertility is due to tubal factor. Ovaries are the female gonads, almond shaped, and size about 2 into 1 centimeter, situated in the ovarian fossa at the pelvic brim. They are intraperitoneal organs. Ovary has two poles, inner or the uterine pole attached to the ovarian ligament, outer pole or the tubal pole attached to the ovarian fimbriae. It has two borders, anterior border attached to the meso-ovarium, posterior border is free, and has two surfaces, medial and lateral. The lateral surface rests on the ovarian fossa. Ovary is attached to the uterus, to the ovarian ligament, to the outer pole of the ovary, which is attached to the fimbriae, the ovarian fimbriae, and the meso-ovarium is attached to the anterior border of the ovary and attached to the posterior leaf of the broad ligament. It is attached to the lateral pelvic wall through the infundibular pelvic ligament. Ovarian fossa is situated at the pelvic brim, and the ovary rests, which is lateral surface in the ovarian fossa. Superior to the ovarian fossa is the external iliac artery. The internal iliac artery and the ureter lies in the floor of the ovarian fossa, and lateral to the ovarian fossa is the obturator vessels and nerves. If you take a cross section of the ovary, ovary is covered by a single layer of germinal epithelium. Beneath the germinal epithelium is the cortex, which contains follicles of varying size and maturity. And inner to the cortex is the medulla, which contains blood vessels and nerve endings. The blood supply to the ovary is through the ovarian artery, and the veins drain to the form the pampiform plexus and drain into ovarian vein. Ovary is mainly supplied by the sympathetic through the T10 nerve root. Ovary function as a maturation, storage and release of ova. It also plays an important part in steroidogenesis. Pelvic floor forms the lower part of the abdominal cavity and it supports the pelvic organs, namely the bladder, uterus and the rectum. It is pierced by the urethra, vagina and the anal canal, which forms the weak points in the pelvic floor. The layers of the pelvic floor from below upwards are skin and subcutaneous tissue, which is two layers, the superficial perineal muscles, namely superficial transverse perineal muscle, bulbous spongiosus and ischiocavernosus. Above the superficial perineal muscle, we have the urogenital diaphragm, which consists of the inferior and superior layer of fascia and the contents as the deep transverse perineal muscle and the sphincter urethra. Above the urogenital diaphragm, we have the most important layer formed by the levator ani muscle. It is also often called synonymous with the pelvic floor or pelvic diaphragm. And the parts of the pelvic diaphragm are mainly pubococcygeus, ischiococcygeus and iliococcygeus. Of these, the most important is the most medial part of the levator ani, namely pubococcygeus muscle, which is take origin from the pubic bone and inserted into the coccyx and the anococcygeal trephine. Its medial fibers is fused with the lateral and posterior wall of the rectum, and also its fibers decussate between the posterior vaginal wall and the anterior wall of the rectum. These decussating fibers divide the space between the two levator ani into a urogenital hiatus, which is pierced by the urethral and vaginal canal and the posterior anal hiatus through which the anal canal passes. Pubococcygeus has a fixed origin, namely the pubic bone, and is inserted into the movable structure, the coccyx and the anococcygeal trephine. So during contraction, it pulls the these organs, the rectum, vagina and the urethra anteriorly, and acts as a voluntary sphincter for these organs. Iliococcygeus has a wider origin from the lateral fascia over the lateral pelvic wall and is inserted into the coccyx and anococcygeal trephine, whereas ischiococcygeus takes origin from the ischial spine and is inserted into the coccyx. It's otherwise called the coccygeal muscle and doesn't take part in the formation of the pelvic diaphragm. Levator ani is a fatigue resistant muscle and its tone helps during childbirth in internal rotation of the occiput, and during childbirth its tone may be lost and result in widening of the hiatus urogenitalis and lead to pelvic organ prolapse. Above the levator anterior muscle lies the has the pelvic cellular tissue, which has three parts. It forms tough fascia covering the pelvic sidewall. It covers the pelvic organs, namely, or form the outer covering of the vagina, rectum, and the urethra. It also forms the pericervical tissue and the rectovaginal septum and the cervicovaginal septum. It also is condensed to form the triradiate ligament, which attaches the supravaginal part of the cervix and upper part of the vagina to the sacrum, lateral pelvic wall, and to the pubis. Another part of the pelvic cellular tissue is dorsal alveolar tissue, which is fills the space between the various layers and also between the pelvic diaphragm and the peritoneum. It contains blood vessels and lymphatics and allows the pelvic organs to distend immensely. Above the pelvic cellular tissue lies the innermost layer, which is the pelvic peritoneum, which is a continuation of the parietal peritoneum of the abdominal wall. The ureter takes its origin from the renal pelvis in the abdomen and ends by entering the trigone of the bladder in the pelvis. The ureter can be divided into two parts, its abdominal part and the pelvic part. As a gynecologist, is interested in the pelvic part of the ureter. Ureter, when it enters the pelvic brim up to its entry to the trigone, is called the pelvic ureter. Ureter enters the pelvic brim at the bifurcation of the common iliac artery over the sacroiliac joint and lies in the floor of the ovarian fossa. It moves forward and downwards along the lateral wall of the pelvis, close to the internal iliac vessels and beneath the pelvic peritoneum until it reaches the ischial spine. Once it reaches the ischial spine, it moves medially and downwards in the base of the broad ligament and moves and enters the ureteric tunnel in the transverse cervical ligament. At this junction, it is crossed by the uterine artery, and from the ureteric tunnel, it moves forward and medially along the lateral fornix, where it is only 1.25 centimeter lateral to the cervix, and enters the anterior fornix to enter the trigone of the bladder obliquely. The close association of the ureter to the pelvic structures make it liable to injury during hysterectomy. The major site of injury during hysterectomy are: first site is when we clamp the infundibulopelvic ligament, the ureter lies in the floor of the ovarian fossa. Another most common point of injury is the where it crosses the uterine artery, and it is only 1.5 to 2 cm lateral to the internal os. Then when we clamp the parametrium, it is only 1.25 cm lateral to the cervix. Again, when we clamp the angle of the vagina and open the anterior vaginal wall, all these are sites where ureter can be injured. And the ureter is liable to injury in conditions like endometriosis, pelvic inflammatory disease, or when doing surgery on a broad ligament tumor. In radical hysterectomy, the ureter is often depatronized and denervated, and there can be devascularization also, leading to fistula formation. The genital organs drain into the pelvic lymphatics. The pelvic lymphatics involve a group of lymph nodes, which are the inguinal nodes, superficial and deep, along the inguinal ligament. The parametrial node, which is seen in the ureteric tunnel, then the internal iliac nodes lying along the internal iliac vessels. External iliac nodes can be lateral, medial, and middle group, common iliac nodes, sacral groups, and the subaortic and para-aortic nodes. The picture shows the various pelvic, lymphatic, and the group of lymph nodes involved, which drain the external genitalia and the pelvic organs. Lymphatics is a common mode of spread in carcinoma. So, knowing the lymphatic drainage of an organ is important in staging and planning the surgery for the tumor. Coming to the lymphatic drainage of the uterus, the fundus and adjacent part of the body drain along the ovarian lymphatics to the para-aortic nodes. The coronal region drains along the round ligament to the inguinal nodes. Rest of the body of the uterus drain into the external iliac group of lymph nodes. Part of the body adjacent to the cervix drain into the cervical lymphatics. The primary group of lymph nodes to which the cervical lymphatics drain are the parametrial, internal iliac, obturator, external iliac, and sacral. The secondary group involved are common iliac and superior lumbar group. Usually, the cervical lymphatic drain into the primary, followed by the secondary group of lymph nodes. Skipping the primary and involving the secondary group of lymph node is very rare in cervical carcinoma. Upper two-thirds of the vagina drain along with the cervical lymphatics. Lower one-third drain into the superficial inguinal nodes. The posterior wall of the vagina drain into the rectal nodes and inferior gluteal and sacral nodes. Coming to the lymphatic drainage of the vulva, the labia majora, the primary group of lymph node involved is the superficial inguinal nodes, which drain into the deep inguinal and external iliac nodes of the ipsilateral side. labia minora drain into superficial inguinal nodes of the same side. Clitoris drain into the superficial inguinal nodes of both sides. Bartholin's glands drain into the superficial inguinal nodes and anorectal nodes of the ipsilateral side. The midline structures like clitoris, urethra, lower part of the vagina, perineum can drain into bilaterally. Thank you for your attention.